West Africa is an international drug transit hub.
Whether today, tomorrow, or in 1,000 years' time, I will never be a drugs trafficker.
In November of 2009, a Boeing 727 jet crashed in the desert of Mali, killing those on board. But what surprised observers was that this plane was carrying an estimated 10 tons of cocaine. Authorities had been aware for some time that West Africa had been growing in importance as a trade route for South American coke. But the scale of this operation shone a light on just how serious the issue had become. In this episode, we're looking at one of the most crucial, but most unreported fronts of the war on drugs, West Africa, and how the drug war is serving to destabilize the entire region. The background to this is pretty simple. People in Europe really like taking cocaine, and criminal groups in South America really like selling it to them. As law enforcement tightened control on some traditional routes into the US and Europe, West Africa seemed to present an ideal alternative. The last 2 years have seen record cocaine busts in the Gambia, Cape Verde, and Senegal.
West Africa as a region is very vulnerable due to corruption, unemployment, poverty. It makes it very conducive for drug traffickers.
In most developed countries, authorities use the amount seized by law enforcement to estimate the size of the actual market. But in West Africa, the rate of shipments being intercepted is so low that this vastly underestimates the extent of the issue.
It's very difficult when you are discussing these issues as to the magnitude of the impact of these drugs. Data is limited or non-existent.
To get some sense of scale though, some experts estimate that the cocaine trade in West Africa alone is worth about $2 billion a year. That's about equal to the total legitimate foreign direct investment into Nigeria in 2018. And you can't have this much dirty money circulating through already fragile economies without it having a massively corrosive effect. This is a crisis throughout West Africa, but probably the clearest example is the tiny country of Guinea-Bissau. Guinea-Bissau is one of the poorest countries on Earth. It's about the size of the US state of Maryland and has a population of about 1.9 million people, around 70% of whom live below the poverty line. And over the past decade or so, it's become known as Africa's first true narco-state. Experts and journalists argue endlessly over what exactly constitutes the definition of a narco-state. But it's essentially a country in which most levels of economic and political power have been corrupted or completely co-opted by the drugs trade. Colombia in the 1970s, Afghanistan from the 2000s onwards, and Mexico today could probably be examples. So how does Guinea-Bissau stack up in the narco-state league table? Well, here's a guy called Jose Americo Bubo Nachuto, the former head of the Guinea-Bissau Navy. He spent much of 2012 planning to import several tons of cocaine from South American guerrilla fighters, collecting a tidy $1 million a ton as his fee.
We asked him straight up, are you involved in drug smuggling?
Whether today, tomorrow, or in 1,000 years' time, I will never be a drugs trafficker. I just sit here waiting for their evidence. You can tell the truth, or you can tell lies about your enemies.
As it happened though, those guerrillas were actually American DEA agents. And only 6 years after that interview, Nachuto was arrested on board a luxury yacht, taken to New York, and sentenced to 4 years in prison. This wasn't some random Coast Guard officer or local police detective taking a bribe. This was the head of the Navy. He conducted many of his negotiations on military bases and frequently mentioned wanting to speak to the head of the country's government about the deal. The head of the government at the time was Chief of Staff General Antonio Injai, who had seized power in a coup in 2012. That coup became known as the cocaine coup because of how deep Injai's links to the cocaine business were suspected to go. And in 2013, Injai himself was indicted by the US on drug trafficking charges, although he's denied any wrongdoing or involvement in trafficking. So this is a situation where the war on drugs has co-opted the navy of an entire country. And instead of traffickers trying to influence politicians with bribes or threats, people allegedly tried to seize power for themselves in order to better control the drug trade. Over the past decade, Guinea-Bissau may well have seemed less like a country with a drug problem and more like a drug cartel with a flag. But it's only the most extreme example of the narco-corruption prevalent across West Africa. And this has serious consequences for the people who live there.
One thing that we need to address is corruption, because resources are supposed to be channeled to address specific issues like education, health, and what of you, and these are diverted. And so we need to begin to look at the drug issue, not just as a security issue, but a development issue.
This vision of the war on drugs as a development issue is crucial, and it feeds into one of the biggest unanswered questions about the drug war in West Africa. There's a common narrative that money from the drug trade is used to finance insurgencies and terrorist organizations like Boko Haram and Al-Qaeda. This is certainly true elsewhere in the world, from South America to Afghanistan, but in West Africa, this narrative is often pushed by authorities as propaganda to continue expanding and funding fighting their war on drugs. But the truth is, we simply don't know how deep these links go, or if they're there at all.
We have heard a number of times about how drug trafficking impacts on terrorism. Most of these linkages, there isn't data, there isn't evidence on the ground to be able to link or make a strong link between these issues to drug trafficking within the region.
The cocaine trade through West Africa is largely driven by one determining factor: the decision by European governments to keep the massive European cocaine market illegal. These are European decisions destroying lives and corrupting entire societies in West Africa, which, to be fair, is nothing particularly new. But while there may be increasing use of drugs like cocaine and heroin in West Africa itself as a result of this international trade, perhaps what's most disturbing are reports of an emerging homegrown methamphetamine industry. Nigeria's first meth lab was discovered in 2011. But between 2012 and 2017, seizures in the country rose from 177 kilograms to 1.3 tons. There are reports of Mexican cartels setting up operations in Nigeria and elsewhere across West Africa. And 2020 saw a series of bigger and more sophisticated operations being uncovered.
It's not just the traditional drugs that we are seeing now, like the cocaine, the cannabis. We are now even seeing new psychoactive substances such as methamphetamine and all other synthetic drugs. We have seen 2 years back, about 9 clandestine labs were destroyed in Nigeria for the production of methamphetamine.
An explosion of homegrown methamphetamine would be a step change in the West African drug scene. Looking at places like the US, Thailand, and the Philippines, the thought of a domestic meth explosion being added to the mix in countries like Senegal, Nigeria, and Ghana is pretty terrifying. Coronavirus hasn't stopped the global cocaine trade, but it has caused huge disruption to people's lives, leading to reports that local drug supplies are becoming more and more adulterated. Meanwhile, the new president of Guinea-Bissau, Umaro Sissoko Embalo, seized power in early 2020. While there's no suggestion that Embalo himself is part of the trafficking network, local observers express concern that he came to power with the support of the military, reminiscent of the 2012 cocaine coup. So, all things considered, the immediate future looks pretty bleak for the West African drug trade. But one thing is almost certain: the same war on drugs approaches to tackling these issues that failed in all those other places are probably not going to help in West Africa either.
We'd like to congratulate drugs for winning the war on drugs.